is currently in his final semester at JSU in field. And about, I want to say a year and a half ago, maybe closer to 2 years ago, Aaron came to me having met one of the other students in the project who had done a community assessment for this research symposium on what was it like to be blind and attending JSU and doing a community assessment. And Aaron said, I really would like to do a research project. Took my research class and came up with his own ideas related to understanding the barriers of being deaf and blind and going off into the world of both universities and work life. So with that, Aaron began a project that took him close to a year. We worked on it very hard over a summer as an independent study with me. And then from there, last semester began presenting this. And so this is his research. And I thank you for coming to listen to it.
How's everyone doing?
Good.
All right, I'm going to do something a little different. Some of you may be used to this. I'm not sure yet. Instead of like raising your hand if you know the answer, clap. Because that's what the most blind like conferences and stuff do. So if I was supposed to say your favorite color is blue, you would clap.
You're encouraged to clap.
Okay, if your favorite color was purple, there you go. Now, okay. Go to the next one. All right. Now, do you know anybody who is disabled? Clap. Okay. And be proud with it. I mean, I'm also hard of hearing, so keep that in mind. All right. Do you know anybody who has an intellectual disability? Do you know anybody who has a learning disability? Do you know anybody who has deaf? Who is deaf? Who is blind? And it's deaf for me, those who knows me. Deaf, blind, both. That's good. All right, let's see, go to the next one. All right, and now, I am interactive type of person, so tell me, what resources do you know for these disabled population that I just mentioned? Anybody can raise up, raise your hand, or stand up, or anybody don't know any resources?
Well, I have, for example, the magnifiers for the students who have to look at the screen, and I have a student just in the class, and he cannot actually look at the document, the resources, like what we offer on the JSU campus, mm-hmm. like, for example, screen magnifiers, right? To let them read the content of the screen, if the normal size of the letters doesn't work.
Enlarge, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's great. Anybody else got any like resources that you know of?
Service animals?
Yeah, service animals is a good one. All right. There's also, you can have interpreters. You can have, like she was saying, I think, I'm sorry, I'm hard of hearing, enlarging documents and stuff. There's all kinds of resources, but the problem is, a lot of people don't know how to reach into that and utilize resources that are available. All right, go to the next one. All right, the objective, and that goes into what I was, my objective. My objective was to evaluate the deafblind community to bring awareness to the resources that are available and to bring enlightenment to the problems that could be improved. This will be accomplished by providing statistical information related to the population, stories from individuals from the community, and a list of available services. The goal is to ensure this community is being provided adequate service and breaking through barriers that may be faced within the society. All right, the next one is stories. I left my notebook, but it's back here on the poster on the left side. So let's go to the next picture, and I'll tell you a little bit what I know about this person.
You want me to bring your notebook up?
Yeah, if you want to, and then maybe we could have somebody like... I forgot it all together. I don't have it with me. But it's on that poster.
What Aaron is saying is that you can read the stories on his poster, summations of the stories.
Yes, I'm going to give you a little bit of what I know about these people, each person, and then you can finish reading, like, the detail. This one is Melissa. She is deafblind. She is she does karate. She has a son and a husband, and she does photography. She went to college. I think she planning on going back and finish. All right, the next person. All right, now this guy, his name is Jeremy. He was my partner. I met some of these at the deafblind camp that I did. He was my partner, mentor. Like, we helped together, got together and helped bring activities in for the 13 deafblind kids that we helped. He has a service animal right here. He actually goes up and help the Helen Keller National Association up in New York, where if you're deafblind student, you can go up there and participate in the program, and he was like one of their mentors up there. All right, next one. This one is Virginia. She did finish college. I don't know her personally, because when I talked to the people that were running the camp, I said I wanted like several different stories, and they gave me hers. And I think she has Usher syndrome type 2, like I do. The first one has Usher syndrome type 1. If you have Usher type 1, is you lose your vision due to RP, which is retinitis pigmentosa, which is tunnel vision, but it stables out and you lose your hearing. Type 2, which is what I have, you have tunnel vision, and it will slowly decrease onto itself. And then your hearing is stable. I have 60% of both hearing in my ears. All right, go to the next one. You can read her stories right here. This one is, she's a spunky character. Her name is Inadina, and she does not have Usher syndrome. She has what, wolf thing? I don't know, it's back there. So it comes to show, not the stigma that comes with it that I've noticed dealing with it is like, if you're deafblind, everybody thinks you have Usher syndrome, it's the ones that know about it. But that's not always the case. There's several different, like, you can be have Down syndrome and be deafblind. Or, you know, it affects so much different population all around that it's just not Usher syndrome. The first three were Usher syndrome, and she's not, I think it's Wolf thing, something. All right, next one, that's me. Now, this one I can give you a story on. I was born with hearing loss, and we found out when I was 3 that I have a hearing impairment. Before then, they just thought I would be slow to pick up. Well, as I was saying, when I was 3, my mom took me to an ear doctor because my sister was notorious for getting in trouble. And she said, my mom shouted her name, Creepy Lee, and I repeated it like a parrot. And she's like, you do have a good hearing. So we went and got it checked out, and I got my brand new pair of hearing aids. And right afterwards, we went to Walmart. Well, the doctor had told her to turn down my hearing aids when we were in loud places. Well, she forgot to do that. And so I was having sensory overload, so I took my hearing aid, threw them out in Walmart. And then, needless to say, when we got back home, she looked at my ears, couldn't find them, panicked. And then we went back to Walmart, couldn't find them. So that was my introduction to hearing aids. And let's see, when I was 14, I had noticed that I was losing some more vision. Like, see, the way mine works is, you gradually lose your peripheral. Well, I think I was about right here when I started noticing. And I was in the marching band, and I did, I didn't let it hold me back because I didn't know. I didn't know I had a vision impairment at the time. So we, like I said, I was in the marching band, and then I fell off the bridge, and I'm like, I'm like right here. So we went, and like, I was 14, and I wanted to see if I could drive. So we went to the Glencoe, where we check to see if you can see the drive or whatever. Of course, I failed. I'm like, So I have a funny story, and I don't know if we have time, but I'll go ahead and share it. That was also around the time where I got introduced to a car, driving a car. Needless to say, I'm glad I'm visually impaired and can't drive. My sister said, it's about time you drove, so she put me in the driver's seat, and I already told her I don't want to drive. And so, needless to say, I'm in the driver's seat, didn't know what the gas or the brakes was. I got them mixed up, and when she told me to turn right, I thought I hit my brakes and I hit the gas, and I went flying into the ditch. And that was my introduction. It was a Volkswagen in 1975. Yeah. Let's see. So that was when I was 14. When I was 14, I also, like I said, found out I had RP, which is retinitis pigmentosa. I was bullied in school, and if anybody knows anything about disability, most of the time, some of the times, bullying does occur. And I was stomped, kicked, thrown into a coat machine, all that. I was abused, and that was something I had to deal with. And so it opened the world up to me when I went to the blind school. And that was where I found my resource. All right, what's the similarities to these stories that I shared briefly?
The deaf blind. All young adults.
And they were also, we're all productive members. We don't sit on a couch and not do anything because we've had people give us resources. Not everybody's lucky to get resources. That's the similarity that we got out there, we did it, we still continue to do it. Like, I'm fixing to graduate. Just not letting life stop us. But sadly, there's a lot of them where they're sitting home collecting a check. The truth is true. And that's what I found in my research. All right, next one. Alright, what do you think are some resources, I know we covered some resources earlier, but what do you think are some resources that could help the community break that gap?
Voc rehab,
that's a good one, that's an excellent one.
Technology.
What kind of technology?
All kinds.
Self-driving cars.
Yes, I know. I'm so excited about that.
Google Cars. I'm not even paranoid. I just can't drive.
Yeah. I'm excited. I can't wait on that one. But, like Ms. Julie Nitz said, there's technology. There's AT. There's CCTV. How many of y'all know what a CCTV is? I remember. Okay. What is it?
Closed captioning. Is that right?
Okay.
I was wrong.
Yeah. Basically, you stick paper underneath it, and then you zoom in on it, and it enlarges your document. So you know, I use one at my work. My internship, I brought my personal one that sat on my desk, and I'm using it every day. So, that's, all right, next one. Okay, I know this is a small print. It's back here, too. These are the different resources that are available. Organization, there's AIBB, I know it's on there. There's the American Action Fund for Deaf One, or Black Children, Blind, if I can get it right, and Adults. And it's just all the different organizations. I Can Connect. I didn't realize how utilized I Can Connect to allow me to work at East Alabama Commission. And there's a pamphlet on the bookshelf, and they actually, I met a couple of them that are deaf blind, never had, did not have a clue that they worked with them. And
what does it do, Aaron? What does I Can Connect do?
Huh?
Do you know what I Can Connect does?
Yes. They help with, you have to be deaf blind, you have to have both. And they're helping me right now. They help you, their mission is to help communicate. Break that barrier of communication. So they'll bring in like iPads, laptops, whatever it takes to get that communication barrier down. That's a biggie because, you know, like when you think of being deafblind, you usually think of Helen Keller. But, you know, like people say that and then they don't realize what that all entails. Like, you have to close your eyes and just be silent. I mean, that's something you have to break through. And a lot of people don't think about that. It's like you have walls all around you because you can't see and you can't hear. And somehow you have to break through those walls to be able to communicate. So I'm a big advocate for I Can Connect. And all these other resources too. If you have any questions on any of these, just feel free to ask. There's no wrong question. Just make sure I can hear you. communication. There is, let's see, there's communication. Those are different, like, interpreters and all that. There's one that it's an SSP. What, Julie, do you remember what an SSP is?
I know what we, like a cat, like a captionist, like a service support.
Well, I know that's available. You can use a captionist, but this SSP is someone who interprets the environment for you. Like, for example, when I was in the deafblind camp, all the mentors, there was four mentors, and they were on there. It was us, and we, and our camp kids, our, so what they had done was they have assigned all the mentors in SSP and all the campers in SSP. And so we went around, I've been involved two summers and I got clearance to do another summer. But the first one was in Kentucky where they went around and like we was in the woods. So they would say, when you have trees on your left, be careful with the trees on the left. You have a stump coming up on your right. And so, I mean, they would sign that to you or they would tell you if you had some hearing. Last summer, we went to the Bulldogs. So we went to the Georgia University. And that campus is huge. And if you don't know where you're going, you're gonna get lost. And that's when I was thankful to have an SSP. Kept me safe and there's heavy traffic, so that if a car was like, let's see, another thing I just learned too this past summer, they want to keep you away from the road in case a car comes, because you can't see a car coming. So if a car's coming, your SSP will see it coming, and they will push you aside, and the car, you avoid the car. And so basically, it's just like an interpreter, but it's for the environment. So, any questions? Food for thought? Alright. Then, if I'm boring, I'm sorry. There's different publications, and then there's web service or searches you can use. So, here's the resources, and if you need a copy of this, let me know, I'll give you a copy of it, because that's part of breaking the barriers, is getting this resource out there to the ones who need it. And this is all the ones I've been. I think this took me about 2 months to gather, and a lot of people don't have time. So if it's already there, don't fix it, just pass it on, you know? All right, Mitz. All right. What policy do you think that are available for this community? Do you know?
The right to go to school.
Huh?
The right to go to school.
Yeah. And that falls under, go ahead and go to the next one.
You want me to jump to the next slide?
Yeah, just go ahead and go to the next one. All right. Like the so you can go to college. Individual with Disabilities Education Act, and also the ABA, American Disabilities Act. These are all the, there's even policies for the workplace for the deaf one, so that our rights are just as much as anybody else, you know, because everybody has rights. Everybody's entitled to them. And these are the policies that helps ensure that. Any questions? Like the Air Care Access Act, Montana showed me this one. This one helps you with your dogs. So if anybody was giving you problems at the airport, you can just say, well, I know my rights through the Air Carrier Access Act, and I'm allowed to bring my dogs on board. Service animal. And so forth. So any questions?
Is the workforce innovation the next to the last? The one I see that it's kind of decent, right? Or it was adopted in 2014?
Monica, can you speak up?
I'm sorry, I'm part of
it. You talk about twice as loud.
This one. Come here. Yeah. Oh.
I see this is next to the last one. And it helps, workforce innovation opportunity, it like basically just big old policy, and it's just saying equal workplace for everyone. And they have like a little snippet for definitely. Does anybody know this policy by heart? I don't.
It'd be pretty hard to know something that's only two, basically implemented within the last couple of years.
Yes, I have.
It's a very new policy.
Yes.
We haven't talked about it, that's
why. Right. I have, what I can do is I have it on my laptop and I can email it to you, just meet with me afterwards, and I have it already printed, like, on
the
resources
already for work, yes.
Yes, so I can give it to you. All right. Okay, next one. Okay, in conclusion, my research addressed the barriers of the deaf blind. So basically, I'm just going to sum it all up. Basically, there's barriers, obviously. There's, in my research, I found that